alive. Oh God, you are the light of our salvation. And God, in the times of trouble, we can come to you. God, you hide us. But God, we just know that even when it seems like you don't come on our time, we know that you're on time. And so we can just wait on you, Lord, and trust that you will deliver. So God, as your servant comes to break the bread of life on this morning, God, hide me behind your cross. God, I ask that you guide my mind in all of my ways and actions. God, increase all of you, God, and decrease all of Willie, so that your people may hear a word from on high. And so I ask this humbly, that may the words of our mouths and the meditations of our hearts, mind, and souls be acceptable in thine sight. Oh God, you are our strength. And indeed, God, you are our Redeemer. In the precious name of your Son, Jesus, the risen Christ, we still do pray. Amen. Can we give our young people a hand clap today for their excellent work? It says, train up a child in the way that he or she should go, and when they are old, they won't depart from this. They're going to remember this day where you encourage them to be all that they can be in God. If you can stand on your feet with me and hold your Bibles up as our pastor encourages us to do, and say with me, this is my Bible, and this is my guide to living. This is my Bible, and this is my guide to living. If you can turn with me to the 91st numbered Psalms, Psalms 91. The 91st numbered Psalm. And I promise you, we're just going to read the first two verses. And I'm going to get you up out of here on this day. 91st number Psalms. I see some pages still flipping, so I'm going to be patient. If you got your iPhones, iPads, just scroll on down. You got a cheat sheet. Psalms 91. And it reads as such. Whoever dwells in the shelter of the Most High will rest in the shadows of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God, in whom I trust. Old King James Version uses said a little different. It says that whoever dwells in the secret place of the Most High will rest in the shadows of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God, our God, in whom I'll trust. If I could preach from a topic on a day, I'll preach, I'm covered up. Come on, look to your neighbor, tell him, I'm covered up. Find another neighbor, tell him, I'm covered up. Amen. You may be seated in the house of God. My brothers and sisters, it's Valentine's Day. Y'all ain't smiling enough. Y'all got the red on. It's Valentine's Day. And happy Valentine's to each and every one of you. But I'm happy about this Valentine's Day because this is my first Valentine's Day as an engaged man. I'm an engaged man to my beautiful, intelligent, and lovely fiancée, Devin Nicole Cromartie. I'm learning fast in the room. Now, this is a day where we celebrate the love that we share between one another. And usually we traditionally exchange gifts that signify some seeming value as an expression of the love that we share. Thus, I'm reminded of the ring that I bought my fiance and all the hard work that I went into buying that ring, all the ramen noodles that was eating and buying that ring. But I'm reminded of the ring I bought my fiance, but I'm reminded of how hard it was to put it in a place where she would not find it because we were always together. So I had to find a secret place. I had to give this ring some seemingly sense of shelter because I didn't want that which I considered valuable to intentionally or unintentionally be surfaced or caused any harm. And so I hid it in a real good spot. I hid it in this secret place so well that I almost hid it from myself. But I did this because it had value to me. As a representation of the protection and the love and the trust and fidelity that would be placed in me by my future wife. And when something has value to you, you don't want it to intentionally or unintentionally come into any type of harm. I'll say it again, when something has value to you, you don't want any harm to come up against. If it means anything to you, if it has some sense of concern to you, if you value it, then anything that comes its way, you want to protect it. And some of y'all still looking at me like I'm talking about a ring, but the God that we serve sees each and every one of us as so valuable that when you need refuge, when you need shelter, when you need a secret place, God provides. That secret place is a place that's so protected that even when someone or something is looking to discover it, it still can't be found. That secret place, when you're in the secret place, you know that there's comfort. You know that you're protected. You know that you are shielded when you're in the secret place of the Most High. You're hidden in the holiness of God's divine discretion. So that even when the enemy seems to issue a hit to exterminate your existence, God's covering envelops your whole being. That's why the Bible says that you are my hiding place. You keep me from trouble, God. God, thou art my hiding place because you are my shield. That's why the songwriter said, Rock of ages, clap for me. Let me hide myself in thee, for when you're in the secret place, hidden in the secret places of God, then you can trust that you're completely covered up. Which brings me to the first thing that I want to talk about today, which is that you must realize that when you're covered up, that your covering is constituted by your close communion with God. I'll say it again, I want you to get this. Your covering is constituted by your close communion with God. The psalmist acknowledges that if one is to garner covering from the Most High, then one must have a relationship with God. Y'all got quiet on me right there. If you're going to garner any sense of covering from God, then you must have a relationship with God. Therefore, you must actively abide in God so that you establish a personal residency in the shelter that God provides. For it is the shelter of God that we find protection from the elements that potentially present us harm. Now, one must understand that this psalm is one that's untitled and unnamed, and it doesn't even give us an ascribed author. And scholars suggest that there are differences of opinions in who penned this psalm. Psalm suggests that it was from the beautiful mind of that one that we call David. We remember David, the one who said, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want, who maketh me lie down in green pastures." Others suggest that this is a battle hymn that soldiers from the Israelite armies went into battle singing, saying, "The Lord is a shelter. In him you'll find rest." Others suggest that this is a psalm penned in that of the voice of Moses. And in this Lenten season, we know that Moses iterated the protection that God provides. We remember the Passover as we celebrate this Lenten season, and as God went through all of Egypt. And he said, "Put up some blood on the post to cover you, and I will shield you from the death angel." We remember this in this season. Others suggest that this psalm may have came just from a brother or sister who was seeking refuge from a persecutor that was running towards them, and they found refuge in the temple. I'll make it plain. This was a person that was just coming to the church to escape the problems that they were going through. This was a person that was coming to the church because they were dealing with some issues in their homes, dealing with some issues on their jobs, dealing with some issues in their personal life, dealing with some issues in their faith, and they came in seeking refuge. And may I pause right there and suggest that the church should be a refuge? Yeah. I should have got more. Amen. The church should be a refuge for those who are seeking to be healed in Jesus' name. The church should be a refuge. And we as church folks should be prepared for those who are coming. That's why the Bible says, "Enter his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise," because we as people of God should be welcoming people into service of praise. But what happens is that people come in these doors seeking refuge, and you got a scowl on your face. You got an attitude. You don't have an encouraging word. You angry at somebody in the church. And no longer does this place become a place of refuge, but it becomes a place they want to stay away from. I want to be in a church where we say, "I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord." When you create a culture of being glad in God, you can testify that no matter what's going on in my life, no matter what I'm dealing with, no matter what trials or tribulation, I serve a God that gives me joy unspeakable when I enter into the gates with thanksgiving. Church should be a refuge. It should be a safe space. But despite the historical origins that frame this psalm, I know there's somebody in here today that can testify that God has been a protector in the time of their troubles. There may be somebody here that can testify that God covered them in the time of their need. When the enemy was on your track, God protected and covered you. when people tried to bring you down, God protected and covered you. When danger was right around the corner, God protected and covered you. When strange storms start to rage in your life, God protected and covered you. When your family start to act crazy, God protected and covered you. When things on your job start to fall apart, God protected and covered you. When church folk talk more about you than God, God protected and covered you. Oh, because when you're in the secure presence of God, then you can be assured that you are safe in His arms. And I can hear somebody now saying, well, preacher, there's some that would say, Reverend Willie, that you can't find a shelter in God. Or matter of fact, Reverend Willie, the others that say that, you know what, I just never feel close enough to be covered by God. May I suggest today that the reason that some of us feel that we can't get close enough to being covered by God is because we have some loopholes in our relationship with God. The reason some of us can't get close to God is because we have loopholes in our relationship with God, and we cannot build a sense of intimacy because we are expecting God's covering while we cover up some things. I'll say it again. The reason that some of us cannot build a close relationship with God is because our relationship come with loopholes. It's contingent upon a few things. And you cannot build any intimacy with God because when you try to build that intimacy, you want God to deliver His covering while you cover up some things. Well, what you trying to say, preacher? I'm glad you asked. What I am saying is that some of us are not covered up as we should be in Jesus Christ, because we're covering up some things in our lives that we don't want people to know about. And the thing is that some people can't see it, but we're afraid that if we go to God with it, God will expose us for who we really are. Some of us have some secrets, right? That people can't see when you walk into church. You're holding some things that people can't see when you sing in the choir. People can't see when you're preaching from the pulpit. People can't see when you're sitting in the pews. People can't see when you're feeding the hungry. People can't see when you're serving as a deacon or deaconess. People can't see it, but God sees it. Can I give you a free one? God knows it all anyway. He knows your past. You can't hide it. He knows your problems. You can't hide them. He knows your secrets. You can't hide them. He knows your lies. You can't hide them. He knows your indiscretions. You can't hide them. You can know your frailties. You can't hide them. God even knows your truths. You can't hide it. God knows it anyway. And I was just brought by here today to tell you to stop running from building a relationship with God because you messed up. Stop running from giving yourself over to God because you made a few mistakes. Stop running from God because you think you can hold something back from Him. Stop giving yourself an excuse to not engage God's grace because you think you can predict God's mercy. Can I give you some good news? That God has always been in the business of taking messed up people to fulfill his miraculous purposes. I thought I was going to get more shouts, but I'll shout for myself. God has always been in the business of taking your lies and taking your cheats and taking your failures, taking some messed up people and making miraculous promises happen. Is there anybody in this place that can give God the praise today? Give God the praise, because his faithfulness is greater than your faultiness. I get excited about that. God's faithfulness is greater than your faultiness. And I just need about two or three people that can thank God, because he's still looking beyond your faults right now and saying, in you I can still bring about salvation. In you I can still bring about rehabilitation. In you I can still be God. Can I push it? Because there's another side of this, Pastor. Because on the other hand, somebody in this place cannot come closer to God because they are victims and survivors of some cover-ups. Some people can't get close to God because they're victims and survivors of some cover-ups. And you have created some secret place of your own to hide the deep-seated pain that you feel. I'll say it again, because that's what God told me to do. There are some people that can't get closer to God because of some cover-ups. And they've had to create their own secret places to hide the deep-seated pains that they feel. And because somebody robbed them of their trust in God, they have been harboring their problems because they never wanted to reopen the doors to that secret place again. Maybe they covered it up at home. Maybe it was covered up at school. Maybe it was covered up on your job. Maybe it was even covered up in church. But God is calling you to come into his shelter. God is calling you to come into his secret place, because God says, I have covering for you. And in my covering, there's healing. In my covering, there's hope. In my covering, there's restoration. In my covering, there's rehabilitation. In my covering, there's renewed trust. In my covering, your secret places can be healed. When you create a close communion with God, you will find that the shelter that God provides is all-inclusive. Where you won't only find the protection that you need, but you'll find the peace that you need. You'll find the love that you need. You'll find the joy that you need. You'll find the power that you need. You'll find the hope that you need. Is there anybody in this place that can say, I'm all covered up because in God I have everything I ever needed? This brings me to my second point. Because when you're covered up, you realize that your covering is so great that there's comfort beyond the assumed confines of the shelter. When you're covered up, you realize that there's shelter beyond the confines of the shelter. God covers you. The psalmist says, whoever dwells in the shelter or the secret place of the Most High will rest in the shadows of the Almighty. A shadow is a dark image that is cast upon a surface by an entity that is intercepting light, which suggests that even when you're outside of the shelter that the psalmist speaks about, that God's shadow is cast. So the good news is that as long as you're close, as long as you're in the vicinity, as long as you're in proximity, you can still find rest in the extensions of God's protection. That's what I came to give you. Whatever you're going through on today, you may not be in the shelter, but you can be close. You may be headed towards the shelter, but long as you're close, long as you're in range, long as you're right there, God has a way. Even if you're not in the shelter, he can still protect you in the shadows. But what happens? What happens is that many of us can only see the darkness of the shadows of our lives. And we cannot find any rest, because when we're in that darkness, we really don't believe God is there. When we start to go through, when situations don't go our way, when our expected end changes, when the gloom arises in our circumstances, we start to feel alienated by God. But may I push us today to try to always see God in the shadows of your life. I want to push us to always see God in the shadows of our lives. Because when we trust that God is present in the shadows of our lives, we realize that even as we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, we don't have to fear anything, because God is with us and his rod and his staff is there to protect us. Shadows. For there to be shadows, then there has to be light. And may I tell somebody who's in the shadows of their life right now that God is the light. God is the light that can shine into the darkness of your life and turn the midnights into day. God is the light that was spoken into creation and made things come to fruition. God is the light. Now, I suggest that if God is the light, then we should be the vessels that intercept the light and cast shadows on the world that protects each and every person that wants to come into the fullness of God. If God is the light, then we should be the shadows. We should be the entities. We should be the objects. We should be the disciples that God's light comes through. And when God's light touches us, our shadow should touch somebody else. Can I help somebody today? That when God's light blesses you, you should be casting shadows of blessing on somebody else. when God life blesses you, you should be able to give more than you used to give. You should be able to help out a little more than you used to help. You should be able to love a little more than you used to love. You should be able to hold on a little more than you used to hold on. Because when God's light shine on you, I want people to see God's shadow in you. What kind of shadow do you cast? What kind of shadow are you casting today? Are you casting a shadow of disappointment? Are you casting a shadow of defeat? Are you casting a shadow of hate? Are you casting shadows of gossip and bad? What kind of shadow? Can somebody see God in your shadow? When you're not even there, can they see God in your shadow? Because when you really can cast a shadow, you have a testimony that even when I'm in the shade of life, God is my Savior. Even when I'm in the shades of life, God is my rock in a weary land. Even when I'm in the shade of life, God still gives me stability. Even when I'm in the shade of life, God sustains me. Is there anybody in this place that says, God, I want to cast your shadow? Brings me to my third point. I'm almost done. Because when you are covered, your covering won't prevent the cracks of life, but it will keep you from being crushed. Your covering won't prevent the cracks of life, but it will keep you from being crushed. The psalmist opens this psalm in a form of a testimony, suggesting that this psalmist has been through some things, that he's had some tough times, and that he could really give assurance that God is a shelter that will give you rest. But if we grapple with this text in such a way that if God is a shelter, then why must bad things happen to good people? If we grapple with this text, we wrestle with notions of theodicy, and we wrestle with notions of righteousness. But came to let you know that we're not exempt from sickness, although God is a healer. We're not exempt from trials, although God is an overcomer. We're not exempt from death, even though God is a Savior. But if we properly contextualize the psalmist on this day, then I would suggest that he understood that just because you're covered by God, it doesn't exclude you from the tribulations of life. Somebody need to hear that today. Just because you're covered by God doesn't excuse you from the tribulations of life.
That's right.
And may I propose that even when we're covered, we still may get cracked sometimes. Maybe I'm the only one that's experienced something in here. Even when we're covered by God, we still may get cracked sometimes. But God's covering keeps us from being crushed. And may I suggest that God still uses cracked vessels, and he still reserves his protection so that his purpose can be fulfilled. I do it like this, Pastor. I just got a new iPhone. Got a new iPhone because my phone was so cracked up. Now, the interesting thing about this is because everybody kept telling me, boy, you better get a case on it. You better get a case on it. You better get a case on it. And so I got a case for my iPhone. And I thought that iPhone can take anything. Anything. It was an Otter case. I spent some good money on this case. Because they said that it don't matter whether it falls in water, whether it falls on the ground, no matter what happens, it won't break. Not too long ago, about a year ago, when I got that phone, I was doing a funeral with Pastor. And as we were exiting the church, my phone was in my pocket. And we cut the corner right there a little bit too tight on a pew. And I heard a crack in my pocket. Now, I don't know about you, but if you spent the type of money I spent on this case, you were hoping that it did what it said it would do. But I went back and looked at my case, and when I pulled my phone out, my screen was shattered. Brand new phone.
Brand new.
Screen shattered.
Yeah.
Inside a case. Brand new phone. My screen was shattered. Inside a case. And so I went back to the box and it said that it never said that the phone wouldn't break. But said it will make sure that the phone stays working. That didn't make me feel good, but God spoke to me in that moment.
Yeah.
He said, son, I never said you weren't gonna have hard times. I never said under my protection you never have tribulations. I never said that you weren't going through some sicknesses, you won't see any deaths. I never said that trouble wouldn't come your way, but when you're under my protection, when you're under my covering, the very things that were supposed to kill you, you live through. And I just need about two or three cracked vessels today that can testify that that accident should have killed them, that sickness should have killed them, that surgery should have killed them, that problem should have killed them. Is there anybody in this place that can give God the praise? Because we're pressed on every side, but not crushed, perplexed, but not in despair, persecuted, but not forsaken, struck down, but not destroyed. Is there anybody in this place that can give God the praise? Because even as cracked vessels, God can still sustain. He talked about lived experiences. I lived. So I can say with conviction that when you dwell in the shelter of the Most High, you'll find rest. I didn't say it wasn't gonna be easy. I didn't say you weren't gonna have problems, but when you're in God, when you have your hope, when you have your joy, no matter what comes your way, no matter what problems you face, God can still sustain you because he covered you. I'm done, let me give you my last one. Here we go. Because once you realize you're covered, you can welcome the calamity of life because your covering comes with a lifetime warranty. See, the reason I like this psalm is because he already knew he had a shout already coming. He went from talking about exactly what he went through and how he's found rest to speaking about his present and what was about to happen in his future. Go back to the text. He went from speaking in terms of what he went through to giving a testimony about what he was about to go through. He says, I will say of the Lord, I will say of the Lord, not that I was going to say, I will say of the Lord, which means that he already knew that he was about to go through a few other things. He already knew that tough times was coming. He said, I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust. And I don't know who I'm preaching to on today, but maybe you're about to go into something. Can I give you a help this morning? Say, I will have trust in God. I will trust in Jesus, because he is my refuge. He is my fortress, my God in whom I trust. I'm done. Here we go. Because the reason I love this text right here is because God already prepares a place for us to seek refuge. The psalmist says, I will, because he already knew that when he ran into his situation, God had already prepared a place. When he got down on his dollars, God had already prepared a place. When he fell down on hard times, he had already prepared a place. When he saw the bereavement in his life, he had already prepared a place. I will be a secret place. Let's do it like this, Pastor. We're going to get up out of here. When I first moved up here, I rode up here 18 and a half hours in a 1999 Chevy Malibu gray. I called to Brenda. And Brenda. That was her name. And this car had already been through a lot of things. And so coming up to Boston was a great time. I stopped in D.C., came up to Boston, came back, went back from D.C. back to Boston because I had to get all my things. And about a couple months in, I had a car accident. And this car accident totaled my car. Yeah, old Brenda had to go on to glory. But I didn't have full protection. And so what they told me was that, sir, we want to help you out, but you didn't have comprehensive protection and full coverage insurance on this car. So we can cover a portion of it, but we can't cover all of it. Well, I said, ma'am, I've been with y'all for a few years now, and is there anything you can do? She said, not about this car, but on the next car. If you get full insurance coverage, it don't matter if it's your fault or somebody else's fault, you're gonna be protected by our policy. Y'all missed it right here. She said, look, sir, it don't matter if you got in an accident, hit somebody, or they hit you. You're going to always be protected. And I just came to talk to about two or three people who only had a little bit of coverage in their life. And when you walked into the fullness of God, you found out that God had already given you full protection. So that from this point on to the end of your life, whether it's your fault or it's somebody else's fault, God has already covered you by his blood. There is a fountain filled with blood drawn from Emmanuel's vein. Is there anybody in this place that can give God the praise because they realize that in their life there'll be some trials and tribulation, but we're covered by the blood? And I'm just thankful that everything I went through, every situation I've gone through, God has covered me. God has protected me. God has kept me. So I got this testimony that he is my refuge. He is my strong tower. He is my bridge over troubled water. He is my hope. He is my future. He is my God. In him will I trust. I'm done. But I want you to remember this, that when you're covered, that your covering must be constituted by a close communion with God. I want you to remember that. That your covering goes beyond the confines of God's shelter. I want you to remember that although you are covered, you may be cracked, but you'll never be crushed. And you'll come to this assurance that when you're covered, that God's covering comes with a lifetime warranty. We're covered. I'm covered. You're covered. Walk with God. Talk with God. Let him know that you are his. And he'll tell you that you are his own. If you walk covered, God will keep you. And you can do this. Testify. He is your refuge. He is your fortress. He is your God that you can trust. Come on, give God a hand clap of praise.